Good to see you here this evening. Welcome to the midweek service. And we got some children going to be singing for us tonight, so we're looking forward to that. And let's all sing together, though. To start with, turn over to number one in your hymn book. Number one, I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, my Savior's love. Number one, once you have it, let's stand together to sing it. And let's sing together tonight, Brother Bob.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. For me it was in the garden, he prayed not my will but thine. He had no tears for his own griefs, but sweat drops of blood for mine. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. On that fourth, he took my sins and my sorrows, he made them his very own. He bore the burden to Calvary and suffered and died alone. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. When with a ransom to glory, his face I at last shall see.
Singing, and we're going to have a word of prayer, and then we'll hear from our young ones this evening. All right, let's pray together, shall we? Father, thank you for tonight. Thank you for another midweek service that you brought us to. And Lord, we thank you for the great love you have for us. And Lord, we pray that you'll be pleased with the service here this evening, and we simply ask you to use it in our hearts and lives. Bless the children now as they sing, in Jesus' name, amen. All right, you may be seated.
One, walking in sunlight all of my journey over the mountains through the deep veil, heavenly sunlight. On that first, let's sing it together. Walking in sunlight all of my journey over the mountains through the deep veil, Jesus has said, I'll never forsake thee. That never can fail. Heavenly sunlight. Shadows around me, shadows above me, never conceal my Savior and guide. He is the light. Ever I'm walking close to His side. Heavenly sunlight, flooding my soul with glory divine. Hallelujah. I am rejoicing, singing His praises, Jesus is mine. In the bright sunlight, ever rejoicing, pressing my way to mansions above. Singing His praises, gladly I'm walking, walking in sunlight, sunlight of love. Heavenly sunlight, heavenly sunlight.
Good evening. This evening's missionary message is from Ken, Linda, and Emily Felder of Worldview Ministries. I am grateful for friends who recommended Worldview Ministries to Pastor Brian McLaughlin and Fairview Baptist Church in Decatur, Alabama. I had never met Pastor McLaughlin, but after a few phone calls, a plan was formulated. They chose to partner with us in the Mahdi Translation Project for Northern Uganda. Each project is different, but we estimated the total cost of translating the New Testament, then divided that by the number of verses in the New Testament, that came to roughly $25 per verse. Fairview Baptist Church chose to adopt the Apostle of Romans, all 433 verses. They created a poster for each of the 16 chapters with a blank line beside each verse so church members could sign up and buy that verse. The verses were sold one by one. Some chose to buy many verses. A couple of members purchased entire chapters. Romans 8:28 was the favorite message of several people, so they all wanted it. Pastor McLaughlin decided to auction it off. It sold for $1,000. Yeah. During the Sunday morning service, I was presented with a check. The total was $13,150. We are so thankful for the burden God gave Pastor McLaughlin and the generous giving of Fairview Baptist Church for the vital work of Bible translation. Thank you, Fairview. Late in the summer, I attended some special classes for in-depth study on Bible translation and technology used in translation. I'm very grateful for the instruction of Glenn Kerr, Chief Consultant for Bibles International. I really enjoyed the classes. Some of our group were able to attend with some invitation from Troy Manning, the annual consultant seminar of Bibles International, which was focused on, hope I pronounce this correctly, lexicography, the science of creating dictionary for an unwritten language. This is a vital step in the process of translating the Bible into these languages. The class was a great learning experience. Our busy fall schedule began on September 4th with meetings every week until mid-December. Please pray for safety as we're literally traveling to four corners of the USA. We have been in Texas, Washington, Oregon, New Jersey, and Florida. Next up are the state up north, Ohio, New Hampshire, and Pennsylvania, with Arizona just behind Thanksgiving. I'm sorry, I couldn't get it out. We just returned home from Florida, where we spent 2 days on the Gulf Coast waiting for Hurricane Matthew to pass up the Atlantic side. We made it to our Sunday meeting on the East Coast after the hurricane went through, and we are safe.
That's great. Thought that was a great idea for that church, and to dish out the verses that way. That was great. All right. You got a prayer guide? Anybody need one tonight? Put your hand up, and they'll get one to you. Everybody get covered? Very good. Good job. All right. If you start on the back, we have be praying for the RU Inside tomorrow night down at the prison, and that's been going well. Friday night, had a great crowd here last Friday for Reformers Unanimous here at the church, and then out at London on Saturday morning, our soul winning and bus visitation as usual, Saturday at 10, and don't forget, somehow we got it on. It wasn't on here anyway. We should. The hayride is on Saturday night, and it's supposed to be a beautiful day Saturday. And 72, I heard, for a high on Saturday, and down about 50 at night, so that'll be perfect. And so everything's a green light for that. Just make sure you bring what you signed up to bring, and we'll have everything said. Remember to bring a chair if you can. That'll help with sitting around the fire, all right? And Sunday, don't forget the dinner day meeting at 5:45, that organizational meeting, getting things ready there, so don't miss that. And then, of course, that'll kick off our Operation Saturation for dinner day, getting 15,000 flyers and some additional posters in different places, and those will all be set to go for you on Sunday, all right? A week from tonight, we'll have Harold Pierce. He's with the Armed Forces Baptist Missions. We've supported the Pierces for, I think, ever since I've been here. And so he'll be with us, give us an update on that. Now, if you notice just above there, the other requests, most of you remember Fred Messer's sister passed away on Sunday, Angel. The service, the viewing for her is going to be Sunday afternoon from 2 to 5 at the Jerry Spears Funeral Home on West Broad. And then they're just going to have a graveside service Monday at 11:30. And down at St. Joseph Cemetery, it's the one on 23, as you head down south, real big one on the left-hand side there. And that'll be 11:30 on Monday morning, all right, 11:30. And we want to have a meal for them after that service, okay? And we need a little bit of help with that. We're taking care of the pork and the chicken. They wanted some pork and chicken sandwiches. We're going to put them on the, it says here, slider buns. I guess. Anybody know what, you know what a slider bun is? Yeah, okay, the small ones. And that they I guess the name from what? They're supposed to just slide on down? Is that the idea? And we'd like to have about a dozen, well, 12 dozen of those slider buns. Can anybody bring some of those? You don't have to bring all 12 dozen, but how many can you bring? Cindy? Two, three? Okay, I got three. Lindy, two more. Okay, that's five. Pull label two. Wallace, that's nine. I'm only lacking three. Leanne, you bring three, okay. All right. Now, macaroni and cheese, they're talking about, it says here, five half pans. I don't know what that exactly means for you. What does that mean? How do I go buy a half pan of macaroni and cheese? I think it comes in boxes, doesn't it? Oh, GFS.
I'd rather not craft mac and cheese. Let's do real mac and cheese.
GFS, you buy them. Yeah. It's already there, and you just have to warm them up. Okay.
Or
all right. Okay. All right. Anybody help with the mac and cheese? Yeah. Jeanette? Jeanette, you'll do one half pan?
I'll do two.
Jeanette, two. Okay. Anybody else help with the mac and cheese? All right. Green beans to go with that. Three number 10 cans. Anybody help with green beans? Just pick up a can number 10. Emma, Margaret, and Kay Wallace. Okay. And then it says here, is that a 10-pound bag of salad? Just a big bag of salad. Anybody get that? Pick that up for us. Terry? Okay. All right. Now, dessert, they just wanted some fruit cobblers. Anybody do anybody good at making cobbler? If you're not any good at it, don't worry about it. But you can get them pre-made, I guess, too. You can get those pre-made, too? Wow. Okay. GFS is the place, huh? All right, anybody get a cobbler and bring it in? Anybody? Going once, going twice? Jeanette? Okay, that's all right. That'll work. All right, Jeanette. Was that Lindy? Okay. Okay. All right, that's good. That's good. Okay, and I got the water and the tea already cared for, so I think we got it. Okay. All right, very good. Thank you for helping out with that. I know the Messers will appreciate that, and be praying for the family. And Angel was only 35 years old, and so pray for them. You have a question back here? Okay, Sunday, bring it in Sunday if you can, and if not, Monday morning early by 11 or so. Probably, I'm thinking 11:30 down there. We'll probably be back here by 12:30. Usually not a long service at a graveside, so we'll do it that way. All right? Yes, Jeanette? Yes. Yes, we do. Thank you for asking. All right. On the inside, of course, are the praise reports. We had a great night at CRC. There were 15 there on Thursday night, six new men, and four of them received Christ as their Savior. And it was a good night there. And we have 14 at London on Saturday, all returnees there. All right. Be praying for the church requests and the church ministries. And, of course, be praying for the those on our health list. And particularly, most of you heard about Lydia. Was in a car accident. Let's see, what's today? Wednesday. That was Tuesday morning, I believe it was. And she's at Children's Hospital. She has a fractured jaw in three places. And she'll have surgery for that Friday. All right, so be in prayer for Lydia and for healing for her and for God to work in her heart through this, okay? And the other requests there, as you see, praying for those in authority. Praying for our military, praying for these who battle cancer, and then praying for these for salvation as well. Pray you keep those in mind and pray for them. And then, of course, our unreached people groups, praying for God to get the gospel to them. That was a amazing statement, you know, he made. Can you imagine? I mean, most of us are still trying to figure out the English alphabet. You can imagine trying to come up with an alphabet for a language that hasn't even been invented yet. And the task that must be. But there is a study of that. There is a universal alphabet. I did not know that until just a few years ago. And people work off of that and such. But that's a great tool and a great ministry. And pray that these unreached groups can be reached. And then pray for Worldview Ministries, all of our missionaries, but especially Worldview tonight and Brother Fielder, and the different projects they have going on translation-wise throughout around the world, and that God will meet the needs there. It's a blessing to have the Yoders with us tonight. They were out preaching, and well, not they weren't preaching, but Dave was, and Terry was along, and two different churches on Sunday, and they've been busy and conferences and such, and it's always a delight when they're in town and get to be with us. And I'm going to have Brother Dave come and lead us in our prayer this evening. And as he leads us audibly, pray along with him silently, will you please, Brother Yoder?
Let's pray. Our kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we do thank you for allowing us to come before your throne tonight and bring our request to you. Lord, we thank you that you have the power to meet any of these needs. And so we'd ask, Lord, that you would please be with those here among us tonight in this congregation that have a great need or a loss of a loved one or something that's touching their heart particularly. We would thank you for Brother Fielder and allowing us to support the ministry that he does and the translation work and everything that's involved with that. We'd ask that you'd encourage them, strengthen them, allow them to continue to do more for you before you return. But again, Lord, we'd ask that you'd bless their family. We thank you for the answers to prayer and the allowing us to be in the prisons and help these men. We thank you for the success that they've had and people being saved and getting the gospel out and giving them good, sound doctrine. And we pray that you'd allow this ministry to continue. We would pray for those that have health needs, Lord, that, again, are our relatives and friends that we know and members of this church. We'd ask that you would strengthen them and raise them up, heal them. That's our request to you, but we pray that your will would be done. Lord, we do not want to do anything that would detract from your honor and your glory. And I know sometimes people go through things because you're trying to get their attention. But again, Lord, we'd ask that you would please put your hand upon them. We pray for our military at this time, that you would strengthen them. I pray for those that are considering what life is about and those that are under conviction from preaching that they've heard and just the things that they've seen with their eyes, that you would be very near to them and many of those young men would be saved before it's eternally too late. We think of this time of unrest in our own country as it is very near the election time. And Lord, we would ask that we would help give us wisdom to vote in the way that Christians should. And we thank you for allowing us to be in a country to where we can read our Bibles freely, where we can assemble like this without permit. And, Lord, you've been so very kind to us, and we don't take that for granted. But we would ask, Lord, that you would please extend mercy to us so that it may continue for quite some time here in the United States. We pray for those on our cancer list that may be in great pain at this time, and their outlook for hope is very small. But, Lord, we know in you all things are possible. We're not discouraged at all because of what we see around us. In fact, it helps us put more faith in thee. We thank you, Lord, for giving us eternal salvation. I thank you that we don't have to rely on ourselves to try to attain to some figure or to some mark, but we are so indebted to Jesus Christ. I pray, Lord, that we would use our bodies for his service in every way possible in thankfulness for so great a salvation that he's given us. We would pray for our family and friends that are on this prayer list for salvation. We pray that they would be saved before it's eternally too late. We thank you for your kindness to us in so many different ways. We'd ask that you'd be with the Morelands while they're in Indiana today and be with them. And we thank you for the answers to prayer concerning many things that you've answered here of late in our own lives. Lord, we'd ask that you'd speak to us through your precious word tonight. We thank you for your servant, Brother Slabaugh, and Brother Bob here, how they watch over the church. We'd ask that you bless them tonight. Again, we thank you for allowing us to be here and to be part of this. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
A wonderful Savior is Jesus, my Lord, a wonderful Savior to me. Would you stand with me as we sing 228 on that first together? A wonderful Savior is Jesus, my Lord, a wonderful Savior to me. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, where rivers of pleasure I see. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love, and covers me there with his hand. Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. Wonderful Savior in Jesus, my Lord, he taketh my burden away. He holdeth me up not be moved. He giveth me strength as my tank. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covered me there with his hand. And covered me there with his hand. Let's sing that last together. When clothed in his brightness, transported I rise to meet him in clouds of the sky. His perfect salvation, his wonderful love, I'll shout with a million run high. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand.
All right, be seated if you will. Ushers will come to get our offering tonight. And we do have another fellow being released from prison. He's up in Grafton, Ohio. And he gets out Sunday morning at 8 a.m. And I have somebody picking him up. And they're coming directly here. He's not from here. He's originally from up in the Cleveland area, but he doesn't want to go back there. He'd like to get a new start and get a new start right here at Bible Baptist Church. And so Alan is his name, and he's very concerned that he'll be accepted by everybody, and I told him that should not be a concern, that these are he's going to love the people here, and we're going to love him, and help him get started on the right step this time with his life. So just want to give you a heads up. He'll be coming in prayerfully in time for the morning service on Sunday morning, and just greet him warmly and let him feel welcome. All right? All right, let's pray for our offering this evening. Brother Wallace, lead us in our prayer, if you would, please.
Father, we certainly do appreciate the opportunity we have to come and open up your word. And Lord, as we've been studying about putting on the armor of God, and Lord, I just pray that our hearts will be open to what you have for us tonight. Lord, it's so important that we hide your word in our heart. Lord, it's the only thing that can defeat the enemy. So, Lord, help us to be attentive. Help us to be respectful as your servant brings the word. And, Lord, now bless this offering. May everything that we give be given in such a way that it would bring joy to your heart. And Lord, may you use it in such a way that would be joy to our heart. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Got that going, Dean? All right. And Ephesians chapter 6, if you will. The Bible says in verse number 10, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace." Now, Father, we ask for your help as we come to this study again in your word, as we put on the whole armor of God. I pray, Lord, you'd help us to glean tonight from your word the truths that you would have us to glean. And, Lord, particularly putting on of the shoes, our feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. And Lord, I pray you'd give us understanding now in your word as only you can. And Lord, apply this word to each of our hearts this evening. In Jesus' name I ask it. Amen. You know, when you think about shoes, I remember years ago, the lady down in the Philippines she had all hundreds and thousands of shoes. What was her name down there? Imelda Marcos, was that her name? And man, shoes everywhere. And most people, you know what? You'll have casual shoes, you'll have nice shoes, you'll have tennis shoes, you may have house shoes. Now, most men, a couple pair of shoes and we're set, you know. Ladies aren't that way so much, you know, and shoes for just about every occasion you can think of. Athletes all get a shoe that they want to promote and they want people to go out and buy, and shoes are important. Now, you understand shoes are very important for the soldier. Very important part of the equipment is that their feet be shod with the right things. Now, the Roman soldier would not wear shoes as we know them, or boots as we know them. They wore sandals, of course, but they wore hardened leather sandals at the bottom and leather straps to keep them firmly fixed to their feet. And they had the hardened leather sole that would be on the bottom. Because, you know, the roads could get very hot in the summer and very cold in the winter. And, of course, as they go through other terrain, there's all sorts of things that could rip their feet, cut their feet, have all sorts of problems with their feet. And if you have a soldier that has blistered feet or cut feet or hurting feet, I tell you what, when your feet hurt, you don't get very far. And how many of you testify to that, all right? And everything else seems to hurt as well. And so the soldier's shoes were vital. In fact, I was reading as I was studying this that even the enemy soldiers would sharpen sticks to a very sharp point. Then they'd bury those sticks in the ground with the points just sticking up above the surface, so that if a soldier would come along and not have the proper footwear on, they'd be severely hampered by stepping on that. Not only would it cut their feet and hamper their ability to move and to move forward, but sometimes, if not properly cared for, infection would then follow. And sometimes they would even lose their feet. And so it was very important that the soldier would have his feet well protected, his feet well shod. And so when we look at our feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace, God is concerned that our feet are shod with the right things. Now, we're reminded again, and let me remind you again, that as we fight the spiritual warfare, as we do battle with the forces of evil, all right, it is never in our strength. It is never in our power. I'm reminded, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Okay, don't get thinking that you're going to do it by yourself. You have a clever and a scheming adversary, and God didn't think we'd just do it on our own, or He wouldn't have to give us any armor to put on. He must have realized we need help, and we do, and so He's given us this armor to be able to fight Satan. Remember, the first piece of armor was our loins girt about with truth, all right? Because Satan is first and foremost a liar, and you must confront that with the truth of God, and not fall for the lies and deceptions of the devil. The second piece of armor was the breastplate of righteousness we talked about last week. And again, that's the imputed righteousness of Christ that we receive at salvation. And that is a finished product, of a done deal. Then there's the imparted righteousness of Christ that is imparted to us, that is to be walked out, lived out in our lives on a daily basis. The imparted righteousness of Christ. And that righteousness is what protects us from the temptations that the devil seeks to entice us with. So, in other words, our desire for righteous living, our desire for holiness before God, exceeds any fleshly desire to satisfy the flesh, to where you want to please God, because I want to have that relationship with Him, and I don't want anything to hinder that. I don't want anything to mess that up, okay? And so I want to make sure that I put on the breastplate of righteousness. Now we come to the third piece of the armor, and that is our feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Now, it's not right away our mind will tend to run to Romans 10, where it says, how beautiful are the feet of those that preach the gospel. And we tend to think right away that this must be talking about us, you know, taking the gospel to others, or soul winning and evangelism and things like that. But that's not really the context of what he's speaking about here, is it? What context is this scripture in? Spiritual warfare. All right? This is a battle. Remember, we wrestle. Wrestle is hand-to-hand combat. This is a wrestling match. This is a hand-to-hand combat with Satan. Nothing wrong, by the way. It is beautiful, the feet to carry the gospel. That's a true statement. It's just not necessarily what this is referring to if you keep it in the context. He's talking about spiritual warfare. Three times he mentions in this passage about standing, having done all to stand and to withstand, and to be able to stand firm and not slip and slide. You have to have good footing. And to have good footing, you got to have good shoes. I remember sometimes when I would get the old wingtip shoes, you know, and sometimes when you if you get shoes that are brand new and then you step out on the pavement where it's wet, you ever been there? Yeah. If you're not careful, you don't stay upright very long, and there they go. Slippery, it's no good. And I remember with playing sports and playing basketball, you always wanted to have good stick on your shoes that you wore, and sometimes they put mats on the side of the floor and had sticky stuff on it. You can go over and you'd stamp your feet on that so that when you're out and you want to cut and you want to move, you stay, your shoe catches and you don't go sliding across the floor, all right? Shoes were very important. And so he's talking about the fight here, and he's talking again about the shoes on our feet, or our feet being shod. And notice he's saying with the preparation of the gospel of peace. So it's saying it's a readiness. It's being prepared for the conflict. It's the same way, you know, if you're prepared for something, you're ready for anything to happen. And one of the ways you be prepared is you make sure you have your shoes on. Make sure that you are ready to move and ready to go when the general says go. And so we have to always be ready. Satan ought not to take us by surprise. We're not to be ignorant of his devices. We know our enemy, and we understand what he can do. And we're always on the lookout. We're always aware. We're watching. We're being vigilant. We're being sober. And so we're ready to look for his attacks, or else we're extremely vulnerable to his attacks. And so we have to be prepared. Are you ready? Are you prepared? Do you consciously put on the truth of God? Do you consciously put on the breastplate of righteousness? Do you consciously shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace? Now, it's interesting. He calls it in here the gospel of peace. That's an interesting phrase. And it's because peace is brought to us by the gospel that provides us protection from the enemy. Peace, the gospel of peace. What's peace? Is peace just the absence of conflict? Is that all peace is? Is it, someone said, peace is that glorious moment in history when everyone stops to reload. No, that's not peace. All right? It's not just a way of stopping the conflict or somebody who's not in conflict. The absence of conflict is not the peace that the gospel gives. It's much deeper than that. I like the definition of peace that we learn in RU, and that is to be safe from harm in spirit, mind, and body. I'm safe from harm in spirit, mind, and body, or spirit, soul, and body. And there's a freedom from being harmed, a freedom. I'm protected. That's what the gospel of peace can bring. There's Proverbs 3 and verse 17 says about wisdom. Her ways are ways of pleasantness, and all her paths are peace. And of course, peace comes from God. In the Aaronic blessing in Numbers chapter 6, he said, "The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace." So the gospel brings peace, the peace that comes with reconciliation with God. All right? Peace. Let go number one on your paper. I think you have this number one. The first, what kind of peace is he talking about? Positional peace. Positional peace. Romans 5 and verse 1. Let me read that to you, and you can turn there if you'd like. Romans 5 and verse 1. The Bible says, "Therefore, being justified by faith, we have what?" Therefore, being justified by faith, we have what? Peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Okay? That's a vital verse. And this peace here, the peace with God, this is not subjective peace. This is not experiential peace, something that is just by our experience. What this is objective peace. This is a legal declaration. It's a legal fact. And the only way to get this peace is by faith in Jesus Christ. That's the only way to receive it. It's through God's decree that we're justified that we have peace with God. That's the only way. Then what it means is, listen, God isn't angry with you anymore. You say, is God angry? Yeah, God's angry at sin every day. And by the way, I don't want to burst your bubble, but God, the Bible even says God's angry with sinners every day. Okay? Doesn't mean he doesn't love them, but he's angry. And you and I need to be saved to appease the righteous anger and wrath of God upon mankind. I know that's not a popular preaching or popular saying anymore, but it's true and it's Bible. And so we get peace with God. God's not angry. The war between you and God is over when you put your faith in Jesus Christ. Therefore, I was reading this week, and one of the preachers said, therefore, is God pointing his finger to the cross and saying, because of the perfect redemption there of Jesus, because what Jesus did on the cross, therefore, we're justified. Therefore, I'm not angry anymore. Therefore, I'm not at war with you anymore when you put your faith in Jesus Christ. Now, we learned last week, justification doesn't just mean he removes our sins. It means he gives us, he imputes to us the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Somebody says, well, you have to be perfect to go to heaven. Yes. But it's not my perfectness. But I got Jesus' perfectness. It's his righteousness imputed to my account. Hey, and he did no sin. Neither was guile found in his mouth. He was tempted in all points like we are, yet without sin. That perfectness, that righteousness is imputed to me when I put my faith in Jesus Christ. So I'm justified. I'm no longer accountable for any sins, past, present, or future. And I have the righteousness of Christ imputed to me. And therefore, God, in his own plan, in his own way, his own work on the cross, justified us and gave us peace with God. That justification is not a feelings-based truth. It's an intellectual truth. It's you know what it is? It's that's what God says. It's a done deal. And whether I feel like it or not, has nothing to do with it. Okay? That's why, listen, when someone receives Christ as their Savior and they ask the Lord to forgive them their sin and they ask Him to be their Savior, when they're done calling on the Lord and you lift your eyes from being in prayer, the worst question you could ask Him is, how do you feel now? I don't care how they feel now. I want them to know you have done what the Bible says to do. If you meant it from your heart, you've done what the Bible says to do to have eternal life. That you are now justified in sight of God, not based on how you feel, but based on what God's Word says. See, that's just you intellectually affirming the fact that this is true, whether I feel like it's true or not. You see, let me give you an illustration. A Christian was going through some very severe trials, and because of what he was feeling, he made this statement. He said, I guess God's punishing me for something. I don't know why God's angry with me, but if He wants to be angry, that's okay because He does everything well. Now, at face value, you think, well, that's a pretty good attitude. Well, his attitude was good, but his theology is wrong. Okay? He had the idea that God's pouring out His anger on one of His children. My friend, that doesn't happen. Why? He's already poured out His anger on Jesus Christ when He died on the cross. And He's not pouring out His anger on His children. That's incorrect theology. Now, does the Lord chasten us? Yeah, Hebrews 12 says He absolutely chastens us. Why? To correct us. Now, He makes a distinction in Hebrews 12, and you read it sometimes. He makes a distinction there about how our earthly fathers did it sometimes for their pleasure, for their profit, because they were just upset with us. But the Bible makes it clear He always does it for our benefit. He's not doing it. God is never punishing, never chastening out of anger. If you're a parent and you have a child, you have to admit there are times that you've disciplined probably out of anger. And your flesh got the better of you at one time or another. But God's not that way. And so He chastens us, but He's not doing it to punish our judges. That judgment was settled at the cross of Jesus Christ. So you think, oh, God's mad at me. Where'd you get that idea? That's not in here. That's not Bible. He's not angry with His children. That punishment and that anger was all settled at the cross of Jesus. You're justified in the sight of God. You have peace with God. Wow. I wish we could get a hold of that. Wish we could understand that. Brother Yoder, I think, prayed partly that you know, sometimes we think, well, if I toe the line and I make sure I, you know, cross every T and dot every I and do everything just right, then God won't slap me upside the head today. Is that really how you view God? Is that how you are as a parent? Are you just watching your kids? Kayla, your mom and dad just watch you, make sure you do everything right, and boy, the minute you don't, hey! Oh, you don't do that. Parents don't. If we don't do that, God surely isn't doing that. That's against His character, and it's against the fact of what Jesus has already done for us on Calvary. Boy, it's awful quiet in here. I don't know. If I'm always concerned about whether God's angry with me or if I'm towing the mark to keep God from being angry with me, I'm not going to be a very good soldier. If you ever played any sports, I played sports, and, you know, if you're always worried about making a mistake, if as soon as you made a turnover in basketball or your guy, you lost your man and he scored a basket, you knew the coach was yanking you out of the game, you wouldn't play very well. Because you're more worried about making a mistake than you are playing the game. And so you had to have a coach that would realize every now and then, because you're playing and because you're trying, you're going to make some mistakes. But I'd rather have you make the mistake trying to do something than just trying to play it safe and not make a mistake, because then you don't play very well. And neither does a soldier and neither does a Christian, if that's how you're living your life. So that is the positional piece, and that is not subjective, it's objective. In other words, nothing to do with your feelings. That's a fact, man. It's a fact of God's Word. You have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ because you're saved. And so you have peace with God. But then there's a second piece, and we call that experiential peace. Experiential peace. The peace with God of objective peace, intellectual peace, that positional peace is a fact. But the peace of God is experiential. In other words, it's felt. It's emotional. It's experiential peace. Philippians 4, 6 and 7. Would you look there? Philippians is right after Ephesians. Look at Philippians 4 with me, will you? Are you okay? Are you all right? You're not, nobody drowning or anything? All right. Ephesians 4, verse 6. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known unto God. And the what, church? And the what? Peace of God. Now, remember, being justified by faith, we have peace with God. Now, this doesn't say peace with God. It says the peace of God. It says, now the peace of God, it says, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. With this peace, you feel it in your mind and in your heart. We all know what it's like to lack inner peace, not to feel any peace in our heart. A crisis comes, a danger happens, our circumstances arise, and a storm begins to rage inside of us. What do people do when things like that happen? Well, some say, I need a drink. They go to alcohol. Some say, I need a pill. They take a pill. Some will put a needle in their arm. Some will go to yoga or some transcendental meditation or something. They all turn to something to try to find a solution for the lack of peace that they don't feel in their soul. How do we get to experience the peace of God? Hey, I have peace with God. That's a fact. Objective. It's not subjective. In other words, it's just a fact I believe I have to accept. It doesn't matter what I feel or not. That's a done deal. But now, here, this is subjective. This is, how can I feel the peace of God? And it's not with God, it's of God. How can I get the peace of God to be felt in my soul? Well, the Bible tells us here how. Look at verse 6. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. So here's somebody, they go to a pill. Here's somebody, they go to a bottle. Here's somebody, they go to some kind of immorality or pleasure or whatever it may be. But where's the Christian go? Yeah, we go to God. In everything by prayer and supplication. I remember years ago, I had a fellow who was in seminary at the time, and he said, well, there's some things you just don't need to pray about. Well, we got a problem. Because the Bible says in everything by prayer and supplication. And whenever I'm going to approach something without prayer, I'm telling God, I got this, I don't need you. And there's nothing. Without Him, I can do nothing. And so it's everything by prayer. So we find by prayer, time alone with God. Notice it's both asking and thanking Him. By prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. It's both by asking and being thankful to God. You know what that is? That's the believer's tranquilizer. Don't need a pill. Boy, that's quiet. And it says it passes all understanding. That peace that God will bring us, that we'll feel in our soul, passes all understanding. It means that it's above and beyond all we can understand. You can't explain it. So when you feel yourself beginning to shake inside, you feel the storm brewing inside, and you're going to have a problem, and you know that that worry and that concern is mounting inside of you, then take 30 minutes or so, go shut yourself in a room with your Bible, and just stay alone with God for about 30 minutes. Take the Word of God and let Him speak to you, and then speak to Him in prayer. Pray the promises of God's Word to Him. Thank Him for His goodness. Thank Him for His mercy. Thank Him for His grace. You know what you're going to experience? You're going to experience a great calm come over you. You're going to experience a peace that comes over you. Even though, by the way, it'll continue to storm all around you. It'll be different in your soul. You'll begin to feel the peace of God. Do you ever think about this? That your lack of peace, your lack of inner peace, may be God calling you to prayer. Maybe God calling you to come spend some time with Him. As long as we think we have that peace, guess what? We're good. Maybe God just wants us to spend time with Him. Maybe God, and we know that God desires our fellowship. And He says, you just come and spend some time with me and come apart and just focus on me. Guess what I'll give you? The peace that passes all understanding. Most of the time when people get in turmoil, they get all worked up. They're all upset. Listen, you don't need to get on the phone and call everybody. You don't need to post on social media how worked up and emotional you are. You need to get alone with God and let Him give you the peace that passes all understanding. Allow yourself to do that. That's God calling you. So we get that peace by prayer, but we also get it, number two, by realizing God's presence. By realizing God's presence. Notice verse 8 and 9. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue and if there be any praise, think on these things. And those things which ye have both learned and received and heard and seen in me, do, and the God of peace shall be with you. So when I think on the things of verse 8, and I learn and receive and hear and seen in others who follow Christ, and I follow that as well. Notice the promise. The God of peace shall be with you. Satan is never about peace. Satan is always about frustration and anger. A teacher in Bible college told the story about his boy being bullied by another bigger boy as he went to school, walked to school in the morning. And first, the plan was to just ignore him and don't even look at him, don't even do anything. But that just made the bully bolder in what he was doing. And so they rethought their strategy. And the strategy was face up to him. Fight him. Take him on. Well, that didn't turn out so well. He got beat up pretty bad. To the point to where now is that little boy was afraid to even go to school and didn't want to go. Didn't want to make the walk. Until finally dad came up with the idea, you're going to take the walk, you're going to go, and I'm going with you. And he grabbed that boy's hand, and that boy grabbed his daddy's hand, and they began to take the walk. And sure enough, as they got right to where the bully was hiding, waiting to jump out and pounce on that little boy, as he came out, he saw the dad with the little boy. And one look at the 6 foot tall man standing with the little boy, he turned and ran the other way. Do you understand the picture? You have somebody who's waiting to bully you. You have someone who's waiting to attack you. And as long as you're not aware of the presence of God with you and you're not acknowledging his presence, then Satan won't flee. He'll attack you. But you bring along and you're aware that God is there. That's why Jesus said, "Lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world." He's too great, Satan's too great for us to face alone. But when the God of peace is with us, there's no fear. That little boy wasn't afraid anymore. Why? He had Daddy with him. He's holding on to Daddy's hand. Daddy's holding on to his hand. Notice Romans 16. Would you turn left to the book of Romans, chapter 16? Romans 16. Paul writes this great epistle to the Romans. He spends most of chapter 16 greeting different people, different Christians. And then he says, verse number 20, one of the closing verses, you know what he says? "And the God of peace," there it is again, "and the God of peace shall bruise Satan under your feet shortly. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen." The God of peace shall bruise Satan under your feet shortly. But you have to be aware the God of peace is with you. He's with you. Realize his presence. That's why I try to make it a habit of praying that God, make me aware of your presence. Is he there? Yeah, I need to be aware that he's there. You ever think about this? One of the attributes of God is he's omnipresent. Okay? Why? If we knew God was always there, would we sin? Think about that. How many of you parents ever experienced your children having a conflict or having a fight until you showed up and they saw you, and then all of a sudden, everything's good here. No problem. Your presence, their acknowledging your presence changed everything. If God's omnipresent, when Adam and Eve sinned in the Garden of Eden, where was God? He was there. But they didn't acknowledge that he was there. They lost the realization that he was there. You see, you want to realize he's with you. Realize he's there. Okay? So realize the presence of God. The third way you experience that peace is by being obedient. By being obedient. We'll go to Philippians in just a moment, but let me read you Proverbs 16 and verse 7. Proverbs 16 and verse 7. The Bible says this: "When a man's ways please the Lord, he maketh even his enemies to be at peace with him." When a man's ways do what? Please the Lord. Okay? Not it's obedience, but really when you're pleasing, it goes beyond obedience. Obedience is good, but the Bible says, if you think about the verse over in 1 John chapter 3, that we know we have what we ask of him because we keep his commandments and we do those things that are pleasing in his sight. That's where you get to the point in your life where it's not just, well, give me chapter and verse, why I have to do that. That's obedience. But when you just know, I think God would like this. I think God would be pleased with this. It's a big difference. It's a great day when if you tell your children to clean their room, they clean their room. But it's a great day when you come home and you told them to clean their room, and you know what? They cleaned the room and they straightened up the kitchen and maybe they swept the living room floor. And they just did that because they thought you would like it. Now you're getting somewhere. See, now they want to just please you. Wouldn't it be nice if God had some people who wanted to please him? Not only obey him, but here, being obedient to God. In Philippians 4:9, remember the verse we read earlier, "The things that thou hast, which ye have both learned and received and heard and seen in me, do." That's obedience. "And the God of peace shall be with you." So the things that you, listen, the things you learn and receive and heard and seen in me, what are you supposed to do with it? Do them. It's the same thing James says when he says, be doers of the word and not hearers only. What are you supposed to do when you, listen, the people you see it in church, the other believers who are exhorting you and trying to help you, not only by what they say, but by how they live. What are you supposed to do with the teaching from God's Word and the preaching from God's Word? The things you hear and the things you receive. What are you supposed to do? Walk out and say, well, that was a nice sermon. What's on the radio? Oh, that's a nice message. Oh, let's see, where do we want to eat? No, what are you supposed to do with it? You're supposed to do it. You're supposed to obey it. You're not just here to say, oh, that was a nice message. No, you're supposed to say, God, what do you want me to do? And then I'm going to do it. Disobedience, listen, as you walk in obedience to what you've learned, received, and heard and seen in me, the God of peace will be with you. And if the God of peace is with you, you're protected from Satan. Do you understand? He's going to protect you. Disobedience will remove that protective peace. And it opens us up to the attack of the enemy. You know, King Saul, back in 1 Samuel chapter 15, his downfall was a lack of obedience. What was he told about the Amalekites and King Agag? Kill everything. I mean, don't spare anything. But he spared the king, and he spared the best of the sheep and the best of the oxen. Oh, but hey, I had a good reason. I spared those so I could sacrifice to God. Doesn't that sound good? Doesn't that sound worthy and noble? But that's why Samuel replied through God, God speaking through Samuel to Saul in verses 22 and 23 of 1 Samuel 15. And when he said, at the Lord is great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices, as in obeying the voice of the Lord. Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken than the fat of rams. For rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. Because thou hast rejected the word of the Lord, he hath rejected thee from being king. I want you to look at 1 Corinthians chapter 10, if you would. And by the way, you know, if you're familiar with that story at all, from that point forward, Saul still had the crown on his head. But how was the rest of his life? Troubled. Never really couldn't trust anybody. Didn't think anybody who was a friend to him. Even distrusted his own children. And called into question their love and their loyalty. Tried to kill David. Even though God told us several times, David behaved himself wisely. God telling us that was nothing on David's side that was causing this. This was Saul. And from time to time, we know that an evil spirit even visited him. Troubled him. He was a miserable guy. Just a miserable existence. See, just being played by Satan all the time. Because of his disobedience. Now, what's 1 Corinthians 10 tell us? Notice verse number 11. Now, all these things happen unto them for ensamples. For they are written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the world are come. Wherefore, let him that thinketh he standeth take heed, lest he fall. Why did God put that story in the Old Testament about Saul? You know why he did? So we'd learn something from that. So we would learn what disobedience brings and how we lose the God of peace. We lose that protection when we walk in disobedience. And lest you think, well, yeah, that's them. That won't happen to me. Let him that thinketh he standeth take heed, lest he fall. That's why it's amazing where he placed that verse, isn't it? When we think that, yeah, that's what it said in the Bible, but yeah, it won't bother me. I'll be the exception. Let him that thinketh he standeth take heed, lest he fall. The presence of God, the presence of the God of peace, makes us invincible as we walk humbly, dedicated, and in obedience to God. Rebellion, disobedience, makes us vulnerable to defeat. Obedience. Now I want you to notice, look at Ephesians chapter 2, if you would, that not only do we have the positional peace and the experiential peace, but we also know this, Jesus Christ is our peace. Jesus Christ is our peace. Notice Ephesians 2, if you would, verse number 13. Notice what the Bible says, but now in Christ Jesus. That's always a phrase that means salvation. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Okay? It's a phrase that always means salvation. So these are saved people. Once you're saved, you're in Christ Jesus. Ye who were sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace, who hath made both one, and hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us. Broke down that partition between us and God. So Christ, listen, Christ not only gives us peace, he is our peace. He is our peace. So you don't just, listen, you don't just follow a list of things to get peace. You don't just follow a list of rituals or religion to get peace. Peace is not in any of those things. Peace is in the relationship with Jesus Christ. That's where the peace comes from. He is our peace. Each piece of the armor, if you remember, shows us Jesus Christ. It's the same as Romans 13 when it says, "Put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ." It's the same idea, and it's the same every piece. You'll see Christ. When you walk in peace, you're walking in Him. We're justified because of Christ. It's through Christ, by the way, it's through Christ we can pray and enter into the presence of God. If He does not die and shed His blood and open the way up, the partition, that Holy of Holies, that curtain that stood between the common man and God, no one could go behind that curtain and go in the presence of God but the high priest one time a year. The common Israelite, they could not go in and get in the presence of God. But when Christ died on the cross, that 12-inch thick or 12 to 18 inches thick, depending on who you read about it, it was torn in two from the top to the bottom. It's called the veil of the temple. And it came down. Those fellas, I'm told, tried to sew it back up after the crucifixion. And they couldn't. It was too thick. And they could not get it done. Why? God opening the way from God to man. Opening the way. For now, because of Christ, we come boldly to the throne of grace. He's opened the way for us to pray so we can have peace. He is our peace because we're in Him. How important the right kind of shoes are. Peace with God, the peace of God, the God of peace, and the person of peace, Jesus Christ. Those are the shoes we have to stand against the wiles of the devil. Satan loves to cause chaos in the lives of people. You know, when someone's under the attack of Satan, they're characterized by certain things. You'll have turmoil, you'll have loudness, you'll have restlessness, torment. There's an obvious lack of peace. You see that in the maniac in Mark chapter 5. Sometimes Satan offers things that people think will bring him peace, but it doesn't last. It doesn't last. It wears off. And then you're faced with worse problems. How many are old enough to remember Jim Jones? And, wow, quite a few of you. He was called the People's Temple. It was a cult from California. Gathered people together, and it's interesting. I think 910 of them ended up going down to Guyana, Africa. But it's interesting. They said, here's a quote. One of the members said, "Well, the meetings made me feel so good inside. They were so wonderfully, quote, warm and happy." But you know what that was? That was Satan's false peace. okay? 910 people went down to Guyana, and under his direction, for those of you who are too young to remember, they committed a mass suicide and a murder. It's interesting. One of the people who was the first on the scene after that tragedy made this observation. They said, there were no Bibles. There's 910 people. Here's some guy who they all followed. Nobody had a Bible. Tells the story right there. Because you throw away the word, you're throwing away your source of peace. Throwing away that which tells you about true peace. So the Christian soldier, our feet are shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. The peace with God, the peace of God, the peace that is God, the God of peace who is with us as we walk in obedience to Him, and Jesus Christ who is our peace. It's amazing, amazing thing what God gives to us. Well, not next week, but next time. Next week we'll have the missionary here. Next time we'll get together for our study, we'll talk about the shield of faith when we get together next time. Let's stand together for prayer, shall we? Father, I pray your blessing upon your word this evening. May it find root in our heart that will bring forth fruit in our life. And I pray, Lord, that as we consciously each day put on your armor to withstand against the wiles of the devil, you'll help us to have our loins girt about with truth, and to have on the breastplate of righteousness, and then our feet would be shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. May we grab hold tonight that we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. May people embrace that truth regardless of their feelings. And Lord, I pray that then we would also experience the peace of God by prayer, by realizing your presence, by a life of obedience to you. And then we'd realize that it's through a relationship with Jesus. He is our peace. We would stay close to Him and realize that as He lives through us, we will have the peace that passes all understanding. And Lord, that the world is looking for peace. May they realize it's in a person, and that person is Jesus Christ. Now, Father, I pray your blessing on each of us as we head our separate ways. Watch over us. Make us mindful of your presence with us as we leave this place. May all we do bring honor and glory to you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. Let's sing Higher Ground, all right? I'm pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I'm onward bound, Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand, by faith on heaven's table land. A higher plane than I have found, Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. God bless you. You are dismissed. Choir, you come.